I want to thank everybody for attending this meeting tonight. I want to thank everybody who volunteered at Party Party to make that event a outstanding success. We'll talk more about that later, but and we'll talk more about keeping the meetings virtual meetings instead of in person. But we'll talk about that later too. But first, I wanted to welcome everybody, and I don't see anybody new, so that that takes care of that. And then old business. I hope everybody got a copy of the agenda if they cared. But under old business, annual dues are due now for the year. And it's $25. Well, I'm sure everybody on this list is already paid, but in case they haven't, annual dues, the dues are $25 a year, and you can send a check to P.O. Box 1094 in Pine Grove, California. Make it payable to ACARC, the Amador County Amateur Radio Club. And again, it's $25 a year, and it keeps our repeater up and running, and pays for the insurance. So it's really necessary. And I think that's it for that. Next, we'll go on to the Party debrief.
Let's stop on that one for a minute. We've got a lot of people that were on the roster that probably haven't paid, I suspect. And at least some roster. Could we get our secretary to bill these people?
I have the roster here.
Yeah. So how many are there that haven't paid, would you say? Or do you know?
Well, here, let me do one thing.
I sent a reminder last month.
Yeah, Mary Ann was going to send that out. So she's taking care of it.
Oh, it's all already been done.
Yes, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, that's good. That's great. Yeah, I think we talked about it. I keep bringing it up because, you know, we don't want to see our membership drop if we can avoid it.
And exactly.
We do need the funds to maintain the repeater.
Yeah, so there are 26 people who have paid so far that are marked on this list. And it's actually 27 because I just sent mine in like yesterday.
About time.
He hasn't... But remembering to write an actual physical check is just really hard for me. So I finally did it day before yesterday. So he probably has it now. But anyway.
How many members have not paid?
Well, let's see. There. Let me think here. Hold on.
20, 25.
There are 62 members on here, and 27 of them have paid. Mm-hmm.
That's serious, actually.
Now, some of these people
maybe we need to talk about how to rebill them, or maybe it's time to send Guido out.
Yeah, some of these people may not be around anymore.
Well, some of them aren't.
Yeah, and unfortunately, when somebody goes away, and I don't know how to take them off the list. Interestingly enough, everybody on this list is still getting an invite to these Zoom meetings because I use this list to actually generate emails that go into the calendar invite. Right.
Well, Mary Ann.
After we sent out the reminder last month, we probably only got about 7 people that paid.
Well, that was pretty good.
That is good. Yes. Yeah.
I think it was worthwhile.
Exactly.
Effort. Sure.
Yes. 7 a month. Let's see. In 6 more months, we'll have almost everybody.
Or we'll drop 27. Or we'll drop 27 people. 25 people.
Yeah, I'm convinced a bunch of these people are like no longer around. There are a couple of people on here that I know probably will pay. There's somebody on this call who hasn't paid. Well, other than me, there's another person on this call, right? But I think there's a lot of these people are not very active, put it that way.
I've paid, right?
Maybe we need to set up an account with PayPal, so all they have to do is press a button.
Yeah, and there's a few people who have complimentary memberships still because they did our ham cram at the end of 2021.
Right.
That's right.
There are six of those.
Yeah.
Kings.
Yeah, I'm on that list, but I think I'll send you guys a check anyway.
Yeah, you are on that list. There's five other people on that list who graduate in that same class.
Am I the one who hasn't paid? I
think. No.
No, I'm not.
I'm trying to find you. Hold on.
I think I have, but
yes, I'm pretty sure. You are marked paid.
I paid at the Christmas luncheon.
Yeah, you are marked paid.
Okay, good.
Anyway. So
Marianne has done an excellent job on keeping track of everything. So thank you, Marianne.
Do you want me to send another reminder?
I would.
Guido.
Can't hurt.
Okay, yeah, can't hurt.
Okay, I mean,
if we get two or three, that's good.
Okay.
How about if she also adds, if they don't pay up soon, they'll be dropped from the club.
Yeah.
Yeah. We could say we don't want to drop you from the club.
You say something like, don't be left behind, pay ahead, you know?
Yeah.
You know, you should remind them that without their participation, we would not have a repeater.
Right.
Because the repeater costs us money every month.
Yeah, it really takes about.
And without the membership,
everything going, or we
will not have a repeater.
Dues. Yeah, we have to increase dues.
All right, we just had two more people.
Okay, that's enough on that. Yeah.
Okay, good.
Got me.
Does anybody know, have we received a check from the bike hikers yet for Party? Does anybody know?
No, I don't think so.
No.
Okay.
At least
because I guess they would send it to me or at least contact me to find out where to send it.
Right.
Because that I was the only contact.
I hope the new guy knows that we kind of expect some kind of donation.
We
not
can't
my place to remind him.
We
do this as a public service. If they wish to remunerate us, then that's their prerogative, nothing more.
Right, exactly.
Okay.
Or at least that's my view. So
no, that's true.
Yeah, well, you could phrase it in such a way that it would not appear to be obnoxious, I think, to anybody, but if you don't want to do that, that's okay. Because the guy may not, he seemed pretty dense to me.
Well, I'm sure they'll have an accounting of the ride. What they spent, what they made, there'll be an accounting, okay? And I would hope that they would notice that they had not had an expenditure for the guys that operated the radios.
Yes, people.
They should be looking back at their accounting for last year and say, oh, well, we had this and we had that. Oh, here's the radio right. club. Yeah,
it was really 3 years ago. So it may be a little screwed up. Like that, there may be like turnover of people so that it's not the same people, right?
But Steve Anderson will be there at their debriefing, and he'll remind them.
Yeah, he knows about that. Yeah.
Yes, he does. So and they are going to have a debriefing. They always do.
They always do.
I would be shocked after this short a time to see a check from them, because usually I've done big events and usually it takes you about 2 to 4 weeks to get the cobwebs cleared out of your head so you can think straight and get everything handled.
They got to return all that water. They had cases and cases of water and Coke and everything else that they were going to return.
Normally though, they give us the check the day of the event. So they don't, but I mean, they have a new guy this year, and
that requires a with itness that was not in evidence.
Now you're being polite. Yeah.
Let's wait. You know, we can always contact, we have a good contact with Steve, and
yes,
somebody can have a little chat with Steve if nothing happens and say,
well, I'll do that.
Okay. I mean, if you know him well enough to say,
I do.
You know, I do. We really appreciate the new chairperson. We think we're still training him. I wonder if he'll be chair next year.
Yeah. Anyway, any more questions about the annual dues or our finances?
Well, if we get a check, usually we get a check for 500, right?
Correct.
And then we're going to do Sierra Century also?
No, they don't have that anymore.
Sierra Century's gone. Anymore.
Yeah, that's gone away.
Okay, so we just have one bicycle race a year?
Yep. Yes.
Okay, well, it helps, but it'd be nice if we had two of them.
Yeah, it'd be nice if we had another event, some kind of another event to get involved in.
Yeah. Right.
Well, if we were real brave, we could sponsor an event. You'll want to go
there. Okay, Howard. OB, take that up.
How about a Baofeng toss?
Baofeng toss?
Yeah, kind of like they do with the, you know, they have this thing with in
Delaware. Toss.
In Delaware, they do that like pumpkin toss thing where they have like that people build trebuchets and things.
If we do that, can we include walk-ons?
Yeah, I think so. Chinese radio toss. Generic.
Chinese radio.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now the Sierra Century was disbanded because they were losing money big time on that.
That ride was never as big as this one, and it was getting smaller because it's a very hard ride.
Right? It's extremely hard. Yes, it's
not as hard as Death Ride, but you used to see a whole bunch of people with Death Ride jerseys who were riding in Sierra Century, and that was a hint. the serious people were the ones who rode that ride.
Yes,
rally.
That's up at the one at Lake Tahoe.
Yeah, Death Ride is the one that goes all around
around the Lake Tahoe, I
think. Five mountain passes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't have to do all five, but a lot of people want to do all five just to say they've done all five.
Yeah. Yes, it is the bike masochist club.
Yeah.
Have you ever thought about having a booth at the county fair and how much it might cost?
We've done it in the past.
Oh, you have?
Yeah. It's been quite a few years, though, since we did it.
It's $500 a booth.
There is an event coming up in May called Smoke Chasers, which I think is at the Plymouth Fairground. And the GMRS group that I'm involved in is having a table. The Fiddletown and Lockwood GMRS groups are sharing a table at Smoke Chasers. And it's all like fire prevention stuff, right? But it wouldn't be crazy out of character for there to be an amateur radio thing. There. So yeah, it's probably too late to get a table this year, I'm guessing. But I think they intend to do this like every year. So but it's a basically a preparedness fair. And those are actually the kind of events where you might recruit new hams, right? Because lots of people who go to this thing want to know about amateur radio.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I'm going to be here for, I think it's May 17th or something like that.
May 21st and 22nd.
21st and 22nd. Yeah. Okay. So I think I'm going to be here for that. And I may be working the table. I don't know.
Thought it might be a good idea to recruit a few members.
Yeah.
Well, the Colorado Radio Club will be there.
I've got all PR stuff, brochures and everything at the house. I could give you some of those before that event.
Yeah, the Eldorado Club is definitely going to be there because their Eldorado Club is like the marketing radio club, right?
They have a huge membership.
They have a big membership, and they have like two or three people who are really into marketing. And so they do a lot of these things, right? And they're getting famous, like they're getting on TV and stuff like that now.
So Joe, you're going to be there for the Eldorado Club, right?
No, actually, if I go, I'm going for our GMRS group. The two fire networks that I'm part of here.
So could we share a table with you then? Or
I don't know. The person who's doing that is Sue from the Fiddletown group. She's in charge of that. I can send you her information if you want to talk about that.
Yes, please. Yeah.
It's Deidre Mueller putting that together, and she's already got the booths assigned. So I doubt very seriously whether we'd be able to get into it as a radio club at this point.
Yeah. It's probably too late this year. But the thing to do is keep an eye out for this kind of event, because there will be several more of them this year. The Smoke Chasers is kind of big, and it's a new thing and all that sort of thing. But there's usually at least two or three other preparedness type events during the year. And that's a good place to take an amateur radio club.
Okay, Mike just put up a message in the chat about the event. So if you want to check that out. Thank you, Mike.
That's a link to the post on Facebook if somebody wants to see it.
They also have a website.
Yeah. Whoops.
There. Okay, good.
Another person just joined.
You know, the Eldorado Amateur Radio Club is there along with the Fiddletown Neighborhood Radio Watch. And I guess that's, Joe, that's part of what you're working with.
Yes, the Fiddletown and Lockwood.
Lockwood, yeah. You know, if we wanted to have a presence of some type, we could contact Eldorado County Amateur Radio Club and say, hey, can we, you know, stand next to you?
Good idea.
Unfortunately, I am, as I was last weekend, I am tied up with another event the weekend that's going on.
Yeah, I'm actually not completely positive that I'm in town on the 21st because I'm in Baltimore for a total of 2.5 weeks in May. So I might actually not be there this time. All right. Anyway, so that's that. What I would do is keep an eye out for events of this type that are getting scheduled, because they do happen. Like last summer, there was a couple of them. And so they're, other than the county fair, there's like one or two of these things during the year that usually have to do with fire preparedness.
Okay. Well, thank you, Joe. Thank you, everybody, for contributing to that. We'll move on to the Party Pardee debriefing. And I want to hear from everybody who was there and what their experience was. If you were new, like I believe Mike was new this year, we especially want to hear from you, but I want to hear from everybody who was there.
Paul?
Yeah.
We're actually going to make this kind of a program for tonight.
Okay.
Until
good.
You're ready for it. We could do it right now if you want.
No. I want to get the business out of the way before we do the program.
Okay.
Okay. So, good. Next under new business then is field day planning. So Howard or Don, you want to, or Dennis, one of you want to talk about that?
No plans.
No plans.
No plans.
Okay. Well, the only comment I'll say is I didn't think we had a very good turnout last year, and we had more support from Mother Lode Club than we did from our own club. And it's a lot of work. And for me at my age, I found it almost too much work. It was too hot and too dusty. And I just didn't, you know, didn't enjoy it that much. So my kind of feelings are if we're interested in doing a field day, maybe we should try to do it with another larger club rather than, I don't think we have enough interest in our club to do it. That's my own personal feeling.
But that's been my experience over the past few years that there isn't any interest, even from our club, but especially from the public, that we don't get much interest anymore for whatever reason.
Well, you know, I have a good friend that lives on the East Coast, and he belongs to PVRC, which is a big club in outside of Baltimore. Anyway, he said that back there, over the last few years, what they found is they have a hard time finding people that are interested in setting up or tearing down. And so a few guys do all the work of putting everything together and tearing down. By the time they get through setting up, they're too tired to operate. So, I mean, that's, you know, this partly is the age of hams. And, you know, right. Setting up for field day is hard work.
Right.
And I notice also in field day that we have awful lot more home stations in field day than we used to. Used to be it was a rarity to hear from a home station in field day because it's supposed to be a field day exercise. But it just, you know, people just don't like doing it, I don't think. I don't know how you can make it interesting. Maybe there's some way to make it interesting, but I can tell you that 30 or 40 years ago when we had field day, we'd have 30 or 40 people show up and we'd have a big picnic and, but it was a younger group too. So that's part of it. So I don't know. I don't know what the answer is, but.
even 10 years ago, we used to have 30 or 40 people out there, and the Red Cross would provide lunch for everybody. And the Boy Scouts would be there, and we'd have three or four stations operating. And but over the past, especially 5 years, the interest hasn't been there.
I'll make a comment. The location I thought was really good as far as place to operate, but Dennis made a good point. It was pretty warm and pretty dusty. And
not a good place for people just to drop by.
It wasn't a good place for people to drop by because we had a locked gate and we had to maintain that.
Yeah, they could walk up the path, but they had to walk from the parking area. Yeah,
We got a few people, but not very many.
Right.
We didn't get very many people when we held it at Walmart. You know, very few people walked out there to see what we were doing.
Yeah, I think if we want to do it again, I would try to do someplace like do it at like Pioneer Park or something. You know, some like public facility where people tend to naturally congregate there.
Yeah.
Or something like that, right?
Well, unless we have a chairman that volunteers, I guess we can consider it a closed issue for this year.
Right. Well, how about let's just plan something for the club, like a 4th of July barbecue or something like that.
We did well that year when Steve Guillotine made a big brisket.
Yeah.
We had Ed Smith brought a radio out there and hooked it up, and several of us helped him a little bit. And anyway, it was a real nice, and we had the rock crawlers joined with us, and it was a nice event.
Can I make a comment on that, on the field day this year? And that part of the reason there weren't a lot of people there, because we need to do something about the web page. We need to have people have to be able to find it first. They come up on the webpage, and it's how many years old. We need to do that if we want to get people involved. These days, especially, people come up on the web. What's Field Day about in Amador County? There's nothing. So that's what needs to be addressed.
That is an item that's we've talked about every year about the need to address the website.
Yeah, and every year I keep saying I'm going to update it, but I will update it here pretty soon.
Are there funds available to maybe, you know, farm it out, just basic or something?
Well, we have a, you know, basically anybody who could, that site that we rent, you can create a WordPress site. Like what I would do is I would say, don't keep any of the existing site, right? Like maybe download the pictures or something. But I would say, don't keep anything of the current site and just build a WordPress site that does it. And that host actually supports WordPress, right? Which it means that people who know how to edit websites on WordPress can then mess around with the website. Because right now it's hand-coded HTML that Chuck's son built.
Yeah.
I looked at this once to figure out like what was going on because I couldn't figure it out. And then I said, wait a minute, this is just an HTML page that somebody wrote, right? But
what they had at the time.
I don't know if they had WordPress on Just Host at the time. But like our church site, which is also on the same host as the web as the thing is a, or as our site is on, they use the WordPress stuff and they create a WordPress and there's like two or three people in the church who can log in and make changes and all that. And you don't have to be a web Nazi to actually know how to create things on WordPress because it's something that, you know, millions of websites are made with it. So there's lots of people who know how, right?
I use Rapid Weaver to build my websites. And I've always used that, and I probably will use that again if, you know, and I'm sure I have the password someplace.
Does that output to a WordPress site, or does it just output HTML pages?
No, it's a website builder. It's more than just HTML.
Okay. Well, the thing is, whatever you do, make it so that someone else other than you can edit the website.
Okay.
Because if you make it something that's proprietary and only you know, then you have to agree that for the rest of your natural life, you will edit the website. Right. If you make it something that lots of people know, then you don't have to be the single point.
All you need is the password to enter into Rapid Weaver's or Just Host's website.
Yeah, no, I can get you a password for Just Host. That's not a problem.
Okay.
I have the admin password for that. So I can set you up with a password for Just Host and you can go do anything you want.
Okay. This sounds good.
So send me an email saying what you want me to do and I will do it.
Okay.
Just to have a newsletter like Lodi has or Stockton has or something that's current. I mean, a lot of people come up on their website just to read that. You know?
I know. We used to have a newsletter. John Stettler was the editor, and he just got overwhelmed with it, and you know it went away. But if we have a newsletter, we need an editor or somebody who will put the newsletter together. And
right, there needs to be somebody whose job it is to update that thing once a month.
Well, you know, in order to have a newsletter, you have to have some news.
Well, but like, for instance, there is stuff going on. Like we could talk about the fire networks. We could talk about, you know, doing Field Day or whatever. Or we could talk about doing our bike thing, right?
Auto patch.
Yeah. Or how do you
auto-patch? There are some things we could do, but, you know, we definitely have a need to step up the activity level, which I think would encourage more participation. But, you know, you won't know until you do it.
Right. That's
what about just promoting your ham fest? Do you have a ham fest once or twice a year? You know, do something like that and have the on the web page.
Yeah, that's something somebody could host if they wanted to do that, right? If having a Hamfest requires getting a location and people have to show up, then you could do a swap meet, right? Like there's a few clubs that do like a swap meet as their big thing during the year.
Yeah.
Like the Lincoln Club and which one, Loomis, you know, I just went to Loomis. Those are all sponsored by a radio club in that area. So we probably
post the new FCC rules on exams.
After the
19th of April, it'll cost you $35 unless you're just changing your address or telephone number or contact.
That has been amended slightly. It's now you can change your address, and I think you can change your, if you test up, I think you don't have to pay the fee. It's only when you get a new license.
Right.
Or change the license name. Yeah. 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 If you test up, you get it for free.
Right.
Right.
But new hams or change your call sign or.
And 10-year renewals.
And 10-year renewal. Is
$35. Those are the three that are $35.
Yeah. Right. And for GMRS people, the good news is good because the rate goes down from $70 to $35. Yeah.
They tried to make it equivalent.
Well, there's actually like 20 different kinds of licenses that get the same fee now.
We were really low and they were really high. So now we got up so that they could come down. I read the article.
Right.
Well, actually, the fact that ham licenses were $0 is historical. And it has to do with the fact that long ago, ham licenses, I can't remember what they used to be when I first got mine. I think it was 25 or something like that. But somebody like ages ago did a case against the FCC and said, hey, wait a minute, you're charging all this money for licenses and you do effectively nothing for them to get them. When they went to VE, I think, sometime after they went to the VE system, they said, wait a minute, all the people who work on these licenses are volunteers. Like you're not actually, your people are not doing anything, right? So why are you charging people $25 or $30 or whatever it was to get a ham license? And the court actually said, you have overcharged people for the last like 10 years or something. So now we're going to make it free. And so it went from, you know, some random amount, like $25 or something, to zero. And it was always supposed to revert back to something new. They were supposed to come up with whatever was going to be new, but that never actually happened. So it's been like zero since like the early 1980s or something. So this is the time when they went through all the licenses and said, how much work do they actually spend on processing licenses and all that kind of stuff? And that's where they came up with, they picked $35 out of the air to be that price. All right. Okay.
Any more questions or comments on anything we've talked about so far?
I do have one piece of new business.
If you guys want to do a barbecue, I'll volunteer to cook some tri-tip or something and bring it.
All right. Thank you.
Let's think about when we would do a barbecue. Right.
Well, we've usually done it on the 4th of July, but.
Sometimes a bad, because a lot of people have a lot of plans.
Exactly.
So, I mean,
I think in the summer is good, but 4th of July, there's a lot of events. Like for instance, my church has a event that I have to go to on 4th of July, which is
Fourth is not a good time. It should be, it's probably at this point, it's probably going to have to be July or August just to logistically get everything taken care of. But we have to have a chairperson to run that.
Where would you have it?
We've usually had a Pine Grove Park.
Pine Grove Park is a good choice, actually, because people can see it. You can see it from 88. People come in and look, right?
Right.
It's pretty central. You know, everybody knows how to get there.
Mm-hmm. We put our banner up. Yeah.
Yeah, I would say do it there. And the only problem we've had recently with that park is the homeless people living there.
Well, the one homeless guy who was living there, he died. So we don't
problem have to solved.
Huh?
Problem solved. They say the Lord solves all problems. Obviously, he did.
Yeah. So I don't think there's a big problem with homeless there anymore. Okay. Moving on. I want to have a discussion about permanently having these meetings on Zoom. If does anybody want to have an in-person meeting? I'll put it that way.
I enjoyed the ones that I used to go to, but the way gasoline is these days, I guess this is the best way.
And I'm kind of thinking like you probably wouldn't get the same level of attendance if it wasn't so.
Right.
Like people are
usually got the board members and maybe one or two people. Even when we had, I think, some reasonably interesting programs, we just didn't draw people.
Exactly.
Yeah, I think it's just, I think the threshold is just lower for attending a Zoom meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so you're making it easier for people. Right. Unless you're going to have like maybe once a year, have a meeting that has like food or something. And
well, that's the annual barbecue.
You need Christmas party dinner. Yeah.
Well, we have Christmas dinner. Right. I mean, you could do one other meeting sometime during the year and to make that kind of a big deal. Right. But I'm thinking like normally. Things better. Okay. Like most of the organizations I'm in now only do so.
Uh-huh.
El Dorado has actually waffled back and forth on us. They do, they have done, I think they're doing like half of their meetings as Zoom and the other half are in person now, I think, or something. Because they have a bunch
unfortunately, of people. They're unfortunately, running I think we lose a bit. When we don't have an in-person.
I think we doubled there somewhere.
I did. Yeah, I think Sierra Foothill has both. They provide a camera and they have a real meeting at the same time. So I believe.
Well, I think we lose something without having a personal meeting somehow. I mean, this is so impersonal.
I mean, I'm way more likely to attend this meeting on Zoom than I am in person.
You're a Zoom guy.
Simply because I can walk in here, flip this on, go to the meeting, flip it off, and go do something else. Right.
About 70 members, we have what, 8, 9?
12. Right. But we didn't.
Well, we have 27 members.
Well, out of 27, we only have 9. I don't care how you look at it.
That's about 1/3.
We don't get participation.
No, we're having a hard time.
Well, but my problem is anytime we've had when we first did Zoom meetings, we had more people at the Zoom meetings than we had at the physical meetings that were immediately before them. Right? Like we were getting like 12 or 13 people at our physical meetings. And we had like 27 or 30 or something. There's one Zoom meeting we had like almost 30 people at, right? And I just don't think we'd get very many people if we had a physical meeting at the Volcano Tech Center.
The last few times we just had the board and maybe one person.
Exactly.
One or two people. Yeah.
So I think I think it's just done, right? As in like, we're not going to have physical meetings. Unless like I said, pick one a year or something and make that.
We have the Christmas party, and if we have a barbecue, there's two meetings.
I was going to say the same thing. If we have the Zoom meetings all year round, and then the barbecue in the middle of the year and the Christmas luncheon at the end of the year, and I think that would work.
That would work. All right, make the barbecue one of our meetings.
Yeah, there you go.
Right. And then make it kind of a big deal, right?
And we can get, you know, a couple of radios going at whatever park we choose.
Yeah, we can set up a table with a radio on it or whatever.
Sure.
bring a generator. I think there's power in the park.
We plugged in.
Yeah.
There's 110 in the gazebo or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah. No, I think it's a good way to have a physical meeting is to make it like a deal.
People do come for food.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
And have food, right? That will almost guarantee that you get more people.
Yeah.
Definitely. Well, the first Thursday of July is July 7th. I'm going to be on vacation that week, but you don't need me there. So if you want to have a barbecue on July 7th, then we could do that.
Why don't we have it on Saturday instead of on Thursday?
Yeah, we could do that.
I think it'd be way more likely that people are going to come on the weekend than
yeah, absolutely.
Than right.
Saturday
Thursday in the afternoon, and you have everybody working, and nobody's going to come.
Right. And so, and I think maybe the thing to do is like, we have a person who wants to barbecue, so that's great. But maybe have like a couple of different people set up demos of their stations or something, you know, like bring a couple radios and set something up.
Right. Do you have to make a reservation for the park or any kind of?
Yeah, I think you do.
If we do Pine Grove Park, Steve Guillotine had a contact. I can check.
Steve is leaving at the end of the month.
Yeah, he is, but I could get his contact person if he has one and make a call. I'll make a call and let the board members and officers know what Saturdays are open in July.
I nominate OB to contact for Pioneer Park.
And you'll do the same.
Pine Grove Park.
My wife says the club would have to have insurance too. We rented it once for a birthday party for our daughters.
I think we do have insurance.
We do.
We do.
Yeah.
Yeah, we do. Well, I'll call.
We had to have it for field day, remember?
I'll check with Steve and call Pine Grove Park. Or you want to try a park up your way, Don, you think?
No, I think Pine Grove is really the best, first choice.
Yeah.
Other one we have is Pioneer Park up here, but it's hidden back in the
woods. It's hard to find.
Hard to find.
Yeah, we have very good visibility for the public.
Right. Yes.
One that was on 88 or, you know, something, but I can't think of anybody.
No.
Yeah, the only other thing you could do is you could do Dieter Park down in Jackson. Right, that's a big
part. Yeah,
and you got a lot of homeless.
Yeah, then you have the homeless problem. Yeah, that's,
permanent homeless, I think, at that park.
Yes.
Yeah.
But they have a lot of public events there too. Like I've gone to like two or three public events in that park.
Yeah, they do. Well, anyway, let's see what comes up. I'll try to check that in the next day or two, or certainly by Monday.
Get a hold of Sharon and have it at the old auto park there on 88, her big parking lot.
Yeah. Where's that on 88? Where?
The old car dealership.
Oh, yeah.
That she almost sold and then it fell through.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the restoration group, we used to have one of the bays in there. But that was just, it's not a good choice.
Yeah, I think if we can get Pine Grove Park, it's a better deal.
You got some trees and shade and an arbor and places to lay out food that people bring.
Parking's not so good, but that's okay.
Yeah.
The old auto dealer would be pretty hot on a hot day. There was just asphalt everywhere. No shade.
Yeah.
So, okay. Howard, why don't we go for Saturday, July 16th?
Okay. I'll find out what Saturdays are open, and then I'll advise.
And good.
If we can pick, if they got July 16th open, I'll take it.
Perfect. Thank you.
And then we can go from there.
Sounds good.
That gives us May and June board meetings to pump it up and maybe pump up the membership a little bit too by then.
Yeah. And thank you, Mike, for cooking.
That's great.
Yeah, I'll cook. I'll do tri-tip, hot dogs, hamburgers. We can put together some salad and garlic bread or something. I don't know.
Well, let's make it a potluck again.
Yeah.
Let's make it a potluck again. Also, I mean, that works out well. That Linda's doesn't put beans, all the conas on
Linda's
one person.
Beans are great. Linda's beans are great. I love those.
Yeah, I can bring I can bring the Italian sausage thing. I do. You want that?
Yeah.
I do that for our church potlucks.
Sorry, Mike. It has nothing to do with you. You know, your cooking or anything. It's just that you know it's easier to have, you know, more participation and as a potluck kind of thing. Okay, and then you have the main meat and one thing or another, which is great. But you know, it's just
don't shoulder the whole thing. Yeah,
I'll make the salsa extra hot then, so you guys can you know.
I love hot salsa.
Would that be open to spouses also?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
no,
yeah.
Perfect.
Oh, yeah. Family members. Oh, you know, we do. Yeah. We didn't close it to anybody because we opened it to people walking by in a manner of speaking. Okay. Whether they have something to eat or not, that's would be different, but they want to know what is happening. So
I think Joe doesn't want the homeless to come, though.
I do not want the homeless to come.
There won't be that many, big a problem.
If they have a Bofang, they might be able to get in.
I'll bring Boca burgers too for the vegetarians among us.
Joe, are you Italian?
Me?
Joe, are you Joe. Italian?
My name ends in a vowel. It's a good sign.
No, yeah.
My mother was from Sicily.
Yeah, so is my grandmother.
Oh.
Yeah. All right, are we going to do a program?
Yes, yeah.
7:40.
Before we move on, does anybody have any questions about anything we've discussed?
I have one other item of business.
Okay, go ahead.
I would like to leave the repeaters linked.
All the time.
I tried that out for a week, like until whoever did the net this week, they were linked since last week, right? And I left them that way deliberately for the bike event, because we always like the bike event.
Right.
And it has the advantage that if people get on and start monopolizing the repeater, you can get on UHF and still talk because you go through the controller, not through the input, right?
Input. You're actually bypassing the other VHF.
Well, yeah, I mean, if they were talking on both UHF and VHF, that wouldn't work, but they're not talking on UHF because they probably don't even know about it. And so if you go in on UHF, you go through the controller when they're linked and then come out on VHF. So you can talk over somebody who is talking all the time on VHF. Now we can always... AI. Like in particular, K6AAI. But I'm just thinking like the UHF side of the repeater doesn't get hardly any use and we might as well use it, right?
So do we have a big problem about somebody talking all the time on VHF?
Oh, yeah. Well, until I ran them off the other night, and that was the third or fourth time they've been run off by somebody in this meeting.
Really?
Yes, K6AAI and AD6R, I think, is the other call center.
They're not even local.
Yeah,
out in the valley.
One of them's out in Sacramento, south end of Sacramento somewhere, and the other one is like south of here, I think.
Really?
And they meet on a random repeater and talk for hours, like hours.
It could go on 2 or 3 hours.
I listened to them for 2 hours, you know, like a week ago. Right. And then they were on again and they you know, one of them is configuring his Linux system and the other one is like, you know, reading him commands off the internet to do. And it's like, guys, get a telephone. Right. Just like
I would move to leave them linked.
until further notice.
Until we find that there's a reason to do the unlink. The only thing is we need to tell the net operators that they don't have to link the repeater.
Right, they don't have to unlink them. Right, as in don't do or the link.
They don't have to link them.
If they're not linked, they should link them at the time of the net and then just don't unlink.
But if we leave them permanently linked, then they don't have to unlink them.
Yes, but it's always a possibility the thing could get reset and it would go unlink. It would go unlink. So it's a good idea that once a week, the net, if you try to configure for net operation and it already is, that's okay. Nothing bad will happen.
All right. Okay. So does anybody object to having the repeater linked? Hearing none, we'll go ahead with that then. Thank you, Joe.
I guess you're just going to, now you will hear on VHF when I'm talking to my wife and we're coordinating moving our cows around, because I use UHF for that.
You know, well, just be careful what you say. It
might probably be more interesting in those two hams that get on for hours.
Right, so don't, you know, the repeater doesn't get that much use, so I don't think it's a problem, right?
No, it won't be a problem.
No, I'm sure it won't be.
That's fine. Let's try it.
Yeah.
The heck with it.
And we get to hear about your cows.
Yeah.
All right. Moving on to the Pardee debriefing.
Okay.
I want to hear from everybody who was there, but take it away, Howard. I'll let you.
Okay. We're going to have that opportunity. So I've called this a recap of radio communications for Pardee. And most everyone here knows that the club has assisted the Sacramento Bike Hikers with radio communications over several years. And I was trying to think back the first time I went to an event, and I think we were just kind of getting started with it. And it must have been about 2010, but I'm it's kind of a guess. I really don't know the date. And it is a spring event of 100 kilometers, about 65 miles, giving riders an opportunity to ride over a fixed course, starting at Howard Park in Ione. The event this year was held April 2nd, following a lapse of 2 years created by the COVID-19. Don Kirkpatrick served as general chairperson for the radio side of the event. There was also a chairman for the bike side of the event, the rider side, the club, their radio, their bike club. Don's job was to organize equipment and amateur radio operators to meet the communication needs for the event. You're going to hear from Don regarding preparation and execution of the event. In a minute, Joe will describe the technical aspects of the event, including the use of digipeaters, tiny trackers, 2-meter go boxes, and a base console, fondly referred to as the Go Slow Box. Joe will also describe the net control job and coordination with Sagwagon, the chairman for bike hikers, and others. It's a big job, and he'll talk about that. And we will have a photographic review of the event. We didn't get pictures of everything, but we got some very interesting pictures that if you didn't go, you'll probably enjoy them, at least give you a better idea of what it looked like. The final segment, and this is the part you are interested in, Paul, will be an open mic giving all Zoom participants tonight an opportunity to comment on the event. And these are the things I think that we might talk about, the good and the bad, whatever that means. Questions, general questions about anything about the event, and suggestions for the future, because I am fairly confident that we'll have another event We asked to come back. I think we've, in fact, we've already been told they want us back. And they had 900 people out there this year. It was a little down from last year. I think they had about 1,200. But I'll tell you, when you see 900 people on bicycles, it's a big event and quite a responsibility out there on the, for a club, really. So I'm going to turn it over to you, Don, to talk about how you got ready for the event and how you organized people and what you did the day of the event.
Go ahead, Howard. Howard, before you go on, I just have a comment about the course. There's actually two courses. The long one is Metric Century, which is 62 miles, and then there's a half Metric Century, which is 31 miles, and the riders can do either one. So, but there's okay. so there's actually two courses.
That's true. There were actually two courses: the short course and the long course. That's right.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, thank
you.
Okay,
good point. Okay, Don.
Yeah, hi, guys. Well, you know, after the delay with COVID and everything and the trailer being over here in my property and just sitting there, Joe and I decided that we should actually get the thing up and running and make sure that everything actually worked again. So we did that. Joe and I got together and everything worked. The only thing we found out that we didn't like one of the tripods because it was very large, it was very high, was very hard to get the pole into it along with an antenna on top. So Joe had another smaller one. It's only about 3 foot high instead of like 4.5 or 4 feet. And so we traded. And so it was a little easier to put it up. So we did that. One of the other things that we had happen is that the Bionics MTAIO GPS tracker units. The last time, I think that was in 2019, we had some problems with those. And I know that we had problems with the trackers themselves because I repaired a bunch of the battery leads, okay, and then tested the outputs, okay? And they became really good. I couldn't find anything else wrong with them. But the antennas, we did have a problem. So Joe and Howard and myself got together and we tested the small antennas, Nagoya antennas. And this is what they look like, if you can see, okay. They're a small Hershey Kiss thing, okay, one thing or another with RG174 lead with an SMA connector on it, okay. Well, we had 9 of them. And out of the 9, this is the only good one. We tossed all the rest of them. They had bad SWR. It was just terrible. So I had also purchased a new antenna from Nagoya, okay? Brand new. And this antenna, brand new, out of the package, had an SWR of 3.5. Well, we all know that 3.5, that's pretty bad. In fact, that's so bad that that's only what, like 68% of the wattage that's put out goes out through that antenna, okay? Major loss. So it was decided that we didn't want to use those. So I purchased 2 other types of antennas. And one of the ones, the one we chose was a tram antenna. Like this, okay. And that tram antenna, okay, it was a model 1185, okay. It was one that Joe had. And then we purchased it with the RG259 or the PL259 connector on it, so that because it has 10 foot of lead on it. And we don't want 10 foot of lead, okay. We only want like 2 foot. So it was suggested by Howard that we buy it with that connector on it. Then when we change to the little SMA connector, that makes sense, okay? We ended up with this one with the small SMA connector on it, okay? And this was the final one. And these, by the way, I tested each one after I got done with it and I goofed up on one of them, okay? And when I did the soldering, okay? But these are down like 1.6 SWR, okay? So there's a major difference. That gives us like 98% of wattage output and without any reflection. So we got all brand new ones, okay? We had no problems with those, which was really nice. Let's see, what else? We did have one problem with the Bionics is that one of our members left Howard Park, okay, and got to the gate, and their tracker didn't work. And we found that it had can't see that. Okay, anyhow, there's the negative lead off the battery terminal, okay? So we, fortunately, Joe had another tracker. We changed the batteries, okay, and got it set up and went out. I've ordered new batteries. These have 28 gauge copper leads on it, okay? And I purchased new clips, these things, you know what they look like. They go on a 9-volt battery, okay? And they have 24 gauge. So at least it's a little bit better. So anyhow, and that was the only problem we had with the radios themselves, okay? So then Howard and I deployed the Digipeater, which you'll see a picture of, okay, up on Pardee Ridge, which is above Pardee Lake, okay? You have to travel back in on a dirt road through the cattle country to get there. But it's very nice. People are extremely helpful. They just meet us at the gate and lead us up there, and we put it up and then take us back down. We have to be escorted back into there, but that really worked out well. And then we picked it up on the 4th. So, and then we deployed the trailer on the 1st. Also, we came up and got the trailer with the radios in it and took it down to Howard Park and set it up and did a preliminary test with Howard and Joe, okay? And to make sure everything that worked, you know, for that early rise, because we had to be there about 6 o'clock on the Saturday morning, because the first riders go out at 7:30. Okay. We had to make sure everything still worked. So it was oh dark 30 when we got there. So let's see what else. And then on the 2nd, I set up a table along with the new antennas and spare battery packs and one thing or another. We bought all bad new batteries. We found that the old batteries that we had, quite a few of them leaked, okay, were leaking. We did some tests on them and finally we just tossed them all away. We actually had some of the new batteries, Duracells, that were in a package that did test good, okay, and they had a good date on them for life, okay. So we tested those and they were good. And so then I purchased more batteries to supplement that so that we had enough for each of the 9 trackers plus 9 packets of spare. They take 8 batteries in each one of them. So, and we didn't have to use any of the spare batteries. So they're still there. Our other batteries have been depleted somewhat. I will test them and make sure that they still look good or what. Okay, so not a problem. So that was about it. That was what we did. As far as human resources and having hams to operate at the rest stops and the sag wagons, made a request for all the hams, okay? Didn't get much response. That was really quite sad that we didn't. So, and it takes for a full staff, as the original roster goes, was 19 people. It took 19 to do it. And that was running full shifts, okay, which were quite long. In fact, SAG 9 is the longest one. He starts at 8 o'clock in the morning and he gets done at 2, 3 in the afternoon. So I had 17 people that responded, okay. And actually of those 17 people that responded, 3 people from Sacramento area were here. Okay, they went to rest stop 3, okay, and we had one as SAG 9, okay, and Andrew Tai, okay, that was from the Sacramento area. So thanks to Sacramento, we had enough people to fill what we needed, okay, to have. You have to have them for the rest stop. You can probably, and we had, of course, we had Dennis was at rest stop one by himself because I didn't have anybody else to put with him, okay? We were worried at one time that when Andrew had problems with traffic getting to Howard Park, we had Ron Money, okay, that was in with Joe. It was contemplated whether I went out on SAC 9 or whether he did, and then whether we were kind of flipping the quarter to see who would come up with it. But then Andrew came, okay, he had a little problem making it there, and then he went out with SAC 9. So fortunately that worked out. But we really didn't have a lot of participation as far as hams, okay? We had new hams. We had Mike, okay? Mike performed and his wife was there, okay? Tina, remember right, I think, Tina, right? Yeah, okay. She was very interested. In fact, we might be able to get her as a ham. We don't know. I kept trying to push, okay? I kept trying to convince her that this would be a really nice thing for her to do, okay? So I don't know. But we didn't have a lot of response from a lot of our club, okay? It actually took Sacramento to fill all the positions. And that's, oh, hi, Tina, yeah. That's kind of sad. It would have been a nicer to have more people, and that way we could have cut some of the SAG times, and even Joe and Ron, you know, in the trailer. I mean, they were in the trailer from basically 6:30, 7 o'clock until almost 3 p.m. And we left the Howard Park at what, 4? So we pulled the trailer out. So I was kind of sad that we didn't have more participation from our members. So that's all I've got.
Joe, I've got a question. I mean, Don.
Yes, sir.
This guy from Sacramento, you said, was at rest stop 3. What did he do? What was his participation, his job?
He was rest stop operator.
And rest stop 3?
Rest stop 2.
Or 2. Oh.
Okay, that's
two.
That's,
so, okay, I'm sorry, two. I'm sorry, I said three, right?
Because I was manning three. I was manning 3, and you had me confused there.
Oh, yeah, that's all right. So was I. No, at 2. Okay. The two guys from Sacramento were at 2. Okay.
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 One more question now. I've often occasionally heard the term about the digipeater, and I still don't know what it is or how it works.
Okay, that's a perfect lead in. The next section where Joe's going to talk about the technical aspects of the event.
Okay, so I'm going to share the screen, and I have a couple of visual aids here in my hand, but I'm going to start with the screen. Let's do that. All right, so can you see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right, so this is a little bit of a summary of what we did, what was going on. The bike organizers had a bit of fun with creating their logo for the event, which is what's on the left side of the screen here. They have like 2020 crossed out and the 2021 crossed out and 2022. And there, all the t-shirts for the event have that logo on them. And I thought that was pretty funny that they actually just, you know, modified the logo like that for the thing. So this is a little bit about our club operation. So stats about the course: the long course is 100 kilometers, so metric century. The origin, now I don't know if you can see where my pointer is here, but the origin, Howard Park is called the origin on this map. This is a map of the course the bikers actually rode. All these colored segments are the course they actually rode on there. And you can see, like, it starts off in Ione, and then it crosses Highway 88 here. We have to make sure the state police are there so that they can block the road so that people can cross. And then it goes down here on the north side of Comanche to rest stop 1, Goes across Comanche, comes around, that's like Comanche North Parkway there, and then it goes down here to Comanche South, and then goes over to Rest Stop 2. And then there's a long section here that goes, on the right hand, you're going to get into Valley Springs, but it kind of goes all the way around south of Burson and down there, I guess, to Valley Springs. And then then the namesake run is up to Party Reservoir, which is this big, long piece of water here. The dam is right in the middle there, like where the county line is there. And then you come back across 88 again and get back to Howard Park. So that's a long course. It takes bikers probably 2 hours to fill most of the course, right? Like when they leave in the morning, by like 10 o'clock, there's a whole bunch of people down by Rest Stop 2. And then they start showing up at Rest Stop 3 at around 11 or so. And then they will be there until like 2:30, 3 o'clock. You'll have the whole pack coming in there, right? So one of the things we do is we keep track of where the riders are on the course, because we have to make sure we have sag wagons out there on the course. Now, normally the person who manages the bike ride will actually be managing where the sag wagons were. However, this time we were doing that because the person who was doing the bike race was actually, this was his first time he'd ever done it. And so he didn't actually have that context in his mind about like, no, I need to make sure there's like sag wagons on each section of the course and stuff like that, because there's plenty of places where people can fall, right? And the most important thing you have to do is get sag wagons to people who have fallen. Right now, they also help people who, you know, have bike problems, or, you know, blow a tire, or, you know, chain comes off, or, you know, need air, you know, whatever. They provide assistance to people, riders who are going to keep going. But the most important thing is find people who have fallen off and might be injured on the course. The other things about this, we put up, we use these yellow boxes that I'll talk about in a moment to track all of the sag wagons, so we know where they are. Because those use APRS, we have to put up digipeters to cover all of the area of the course, because otherwise we can't receive the signal from their location signal from the digipeters. So these green arrows you see in here are the four digipeters that we had on the course. There's one here that's atop the George Reed Quarry. There's one that's out in the this is near New Hogan, in the New Hogan reservation there. There's one that's at a guy's house that I know in Burson, who happens to be up on a hill. And so he has a good location. And then there's one permanently installed at Mel K6KBE's house in just north of Comanche in there. We have three rest stops that have to have radio operators at all of them, because there's often messages that go back and forth between rest stops, like, you know, we need something, or we have riders here, or somebody needs this part, or whatever, that goes in there. And we have 9 SAG vehicles that need a radio operator. And there's the 900 riders that we already talked about. So here's a little picture, a couple pictures of our net control operation. Down here on the right, you have that's the trailer. And we have a couple of antennas on these tripods set up here. One of those antennas is just for talking to the repeaters, so we can talk to UHF and VHF on separate radios onto the repeater. And the other one is for receiving the APRS location signals. So that's how we track where everybody who has an APRS tracker is at any given moment. The digipeters will relay that signal around the course, and then we suck it up here and put it on a map, which I'll show you in a moment. Well, actually, it looks like that other map that we had, but it'll have the SAG vehicle moving around on it as well. This is actually the two of us, Ron and me, doing some net control stuff. In there, we have the go slow box that you've heard about is this thing on the left here that has the computer screen built into it. There's a computer in there that displays a copy of that map that you just saw. And there are 3 Motorola radios over here we use to communicate on both sides of the repeater and then also to receive the APRS signal. This thing runs on batteries. There's a big battery on the floor that you can't see on here. And then we also have a charger, you know, a power supply that actually normally it's running on the power supply. But if the power goes out and we have to go put the generator on, we can run for, you know, an hour on this while the generator gets running. If somebody deals with that problem, right? We also do, on the left here, you'll see that little table where we were actually outfitting the SAGs. That's what Don was talking about. He was out there doing that most of the time in there. So a SAG wagon would show up here. We would give them a tracker. We would put their radio operator in the car, check out their radios and all that stuff. And then they'd go off to their mission on the course. And then at the end, when they come off duty, they come back here to give us up back. We also run a display that's for the bike riders inside the main hall where they congregate at the end. This is basically a computer monitor with that same map on it. And this one is actually live. So there's actually SAG wagons on the map there. We put our little table with the, you know, logo and everything like that. And I made up a little sheet that actually credited the people who our partners are, who let us put their digipeters at their locations, that sort of thing. And that just runs on a laptop. And I have a radio there that receives the same APRS signals that I'm getting inside and just plots them on this map. So that's just basically a piece, that's an ancient laptop that I'm using there to do that. So what's in a digipeter? This is actually a picture of they're actually in these coolers that have a battery underneath the floor here. There's a battery in there. Normally it's a car battery. I just upgraded mine to a lithium phosphate battery, so it's actually a lot lighter. But what you have here is you've got a radio, which is what actually generates the output signal. You've got a little blue box here, which is, that's the tracker. And what that thing does is that's a very small computer, like a Raspberry Pi. That takes in the signal from a GPS. You can see there's a GPS plugged into it. It takes in a signal from the GPS, generates a location signal, and it also listens using the radio on the APRS frequency, and then every packet it hears, it retransmits a moment later. And we put these up at high locations so that people with the trackers, which are these yellow boxes you see on the left here, that's just stuck to the top of the vehicle. Right, and so that's at zero elevation, right? So they're driving around the course with a whole bunch of bikes and terrain around them and all that stuff. So their signal may not get very far from there, but the idea is to put the digipeters in places on the course where they can suck up the signals from the people who are local to them and then retransmit them. They go to the other, you know, all the digipeters talk to each other and then we hear that information back in IM. And that's how the SAG wagon location gets plotted on the thing. So if somebody drives off the course, which one of our SAG wagons just like completely went off the course, they missed the course. There must have been no bike riders there at the time. And they made a wrong turn. And they're like driving up into Hogan Reservoir. It's like, where are you guys going? So I call them on the repeater and say, where are you guys going? And you're off the course by like half a mile. And so they turned around and went back to the course, right? And so we can tell when they deviate from the course. And that happens every time. There's always somebody who does that.
I remember hearing you say, tell somebody that.
Yeah. It's I'm looking at the map and I'm saying, wait a minute, you're getting further away. Whoops. The other thing about these things is because these digipeters often have to be placed a day or two before the race. When we did the one at the George Reed Quarry, we put that in there we have to go there only when the quarry is open. And we can't go there on days where they're blasting in the quarry. So like we put it in on Friday and picked it up on Tuesday. And so the thing has to run for a while and the battery in it might not run it for, you know, 4 days or whatever. So most of these have solar controllers and solar panels. On them now. We that was an upgrade we did like 4 years ago. I bought a bunch of solar panels and we put them on there. So this is actually a couple of the installations. There's Howard on the right. He has the thing set up. You can see the little cooler there. The antenna is behind it. Okay. So the antenna is this, it looks like part of the tower, but it's not. It's this thing here behind the solar panel. And so that's a 50 watt solar panel, and that's more than enough to run these things all day. So we just plug them in, you close the lid, you put something on top of the lid, and then it, even if it rains, it's not gonna, you know, get wet or whatever. The one on the left is where we were on top of the George Reed Quarry, which is always a nice view when you're up there, because we go up on the highest part of the quarry, like way behind where they're actually turning the hill into gravel. And we drive through the whole quarry with the guy to put this up there. And so this is one that's up there. The solar panel is actually on the far side here because south is to the left here on this one. Okay. Go. Hold on. I have to get this to go to the next slide. Why is it not doing that? Oh, don't tell me you're going to screw this up. Wow, I think my internet got really flaky here. That's weird.
Earlier today, they were all coming up on my computer earlier.
Oh, that was the last slide. Okay. Remember I showed you all the pieces of the the Digipeater, the tracker. This is actually one of my trackers. So looks like a yellow box when it's closed. This tracker actually has all the same parts in it that big one does, except that this is super portable. It's only maximum of 10 watts though. Like that other radio is like 25 watts. It's in there. But this thing has a radio in here. That silver thing is the radio chip. This is the GPS chip here, and the processor chip is actually underneath it. And then it has a little lead that goes to a battery. This is a eight AA battery. So this thing runs on about 12 volts when it's actually running. You have a switch in here, so you can actually select from two different configurations. There's a channel selector switch down here on the bottom, and then there's an on-off switch that's kind of right there. Probably can't see that all. Yeah, so there's one switch, there's the other switch. So you can actually configure that two different, completely different configurations. Normally on these trackers, we have channel one is set to the normal APRS frequency, which is 14439. And then channel two is set to 14441, which is the APRS frequency with this event. And the reason why we use a different frequency. The reason we use a different frequency is because 14439 is a very, very busy frequency. If you take a handheld and type and put it on 14439, the squelch will be humping continuously. You'll hear a squawk, 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 squawk all the time, packets going back and forth. And so if we had these things on cars driving around the race, what would happen is a lot of times they collide with somebody else on a car out on Highway 5 or whatever, driving around, or somebody's weather station sending a burst or whatever. And so we'd lose a lot of packets. So what we do is we deliberately use a different non-standard frequency for our APRS operation. And then up here at the house, I have a big antenna on the back of my house that's hooked up to a TNC in here. And that takes every packet we get and gateways it to APRS.fi. So you can actually see us on APRS.fi, even though we're not on the standard frequency. That's called an iGate, by the way, which is the other kind of APRS station. So we have Digipeater, we have trackers, we have Digipeaters, and we actually have an iGate running, you know, that sucks up all the data for the course. Anyway, so that's kind of the technical side of this. So if you have any technical questions, let me know.
Okay, John, did that take care of your question that you wanted answered?
Yes, it did help quite a bit. I appreciate that, Joe. Thank you.
Good. Okay.
By the way, this is the other type of element we have. This is the blue box that's in our digipeaters. This is one of them here. It's a, you know, basically a little Raspberry Pi type computer inside this box in here. And one end hooks up to a radio and the other end hooks up either to a computer to program it or a GPS. Mm. So that's the other kind of element you can have as the brains of one of these things other than the yellow box.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks, Joe. You covered a lot of good material. The final segment is what President Paul wanted was a opportunity, open mic opportunity to talk about the event for each of the Zoom recipients. So I could start it, I guess, and say I thought it was really a good event. We've had lots of experience with this before, the equipment. We've had a lot of experience, and Don did a good job with all the repairs and new antennas and got everything all squared away that way. I'm not sure how we could make it much better. When Don replaced a lot of the old concrete blocks that we lugged around to set up digipeaters and got bags of sand, I guess, or gravel, something that was fairly heavy, but easier to handle than those concrete blocks. And I'd recommend we get rid of the last of the blocks in the trailer and move over to the bags of sand or whatever the filler was, because they were much easier to handle and they seemed to do the job pretty well. So
I can provide as many sandbags as you want.
That is the only comment I had, really. Well, one more comment. I'll really leave it to Don, because I don't want him to forget talking about maybe how the trailer could be modified some to be more useful for our needs. So those are my comments. So someone else pick it up and talk about their impressions.
Well, I guess I'll take the floor now. I was at Rest Stop 3 and I thought everything went real smooth. I had a partner who was a new member, and I think her biggest fault was the fact that she's not familiar with radio procedures. So I was trying to, Joe, I think you caught on to that too. I was trying to help her along there as much as possible. But outside of that, everything went real well.
Yeah, I think we probably should have a how to communicate on a directed net class or something like at one of these meetings, because the specific protocol you use to do that, because when you are the net control, I have a real problem in that I can't remember things people tell me. So I have to write things down. So when you talk to me, I am writing like all day. And I take notes and I have a sheet that's got everything that ever happened on it, right? And the problem is, if you get on the air, you need to give me your call sign and then wait for me to be ready to take your message, right? Which is actually, that's a standard net control thing. And the reason why is because there's usually more stuff going on than just the net for the net control. So you think, oh yeah, what is this guy doing when he's not, when he's not talking on the radio? No, actually there are people walking in asking questions and wanting to know where somebody is, or you say, can we send this to there? Or can we get somebody to go to this location with a SAG vehicle, or you know, whatever. There's like all kinds of stuff going on in the background. It's very distracting. So the idea is, don't give your message and then give your call sign. Give your call sign and wait for net control to say, okay, SAG 9, go. Or SAG 9, this is net control. What's your message? Right, or whatever protocol you're going to use, but the point is, wait for the acknowledgement, and then at that point, that means I'm listening to you, and I'm not listening to anybody else. Right, when that happens, I'm single tasking on you.
That's a very good point.
And that's got to be, that's really important, because if you screw up a message, you can send people to the wrong place. Right. And that might matter, you know, depending on what your net is about. Right. So remember, this net is practice for what would happen if we, what if we were doing an evacuation, right? And the members of the club were at different places watching people evacuate or whatever, or telling people where to evacuate or whatever. We'd have to be like, you know, we'd have to be really crisp on being able to send messages back and forth very cleanly, right? And so it's very important to actually follow the rules, follow the protocol. And, you know, but I think most people did a really good job with that. Most people did not chat on the radio. Most people kept their messages short, you know, all those good things that you want to do on a directed net. And there were like a couple people who like didn't quite have the theory of how it was supposed to work. But I think, if, you know, by and large, you know, there were 15 operators on the air at different times during the day. And, you know, having only one or two of them get out of sequence is actually pretty good. So I think everybody, you know, pat yourself on the back. You mostly did a good job if you were out there on the radio.
Okay. Any other comments, Joe, while you've got the open mic?
No, it's okay. That's all I have.
Okay.
I've got a comment. I was on SAG 8, and my driver was not familiar with the area at all, and the signage was pretty bad. For a bicycle event this large, there was hardly any signage at all. We had multiple bike riders ask us, where's the course? And, you know, nothing reflected with us, but I don't know who put it together, but they really should have had some more signage. And
we actually sent somebody to, there was a woman who actually was doing signs, and we actually sent somebody to a location where somebody reported there was no signs at a place you had to turn or something.
They were there, and they were, somebody lifted the sign, the arrows off the pavement, the whole section. And she was dispatched out to put reinstall them back down. So we had somebody that was, didn't want the tape and arrows, the different colored arrows, because you have two colored arrows. You had yellow and a red. And, so they knew the long course, you know, the 100 or the 50. So.
Yeah, we had one rider that was going the total wrong way, and he turned around and he completed the whole course, the 62 miles, but it was delayed a lot. You know, we came multiple people like that. Which way do I go? Where's it going? That was my comment on it anyway, so.
We had that trouble at SAG 5 too. We had a driver that was doing the short course rider, and she was more than halfway through the long course. Yeah. Same problem.
I'll jump in if I may. Sure. On the plus side, I have to say, when I got to the park to go out, everything was very smooth. I mean, and I give you incredibly big approval and, you know, kudos and everything for the tiny trackers. I was really impressed with the way they were packaged. It worked well. It was easy to put them up there. It was easy to take them off when we were finished. I hope that you were getting our signal all the time. Really excellent. You had everything ready for us to go. The one comment I have is leading back to radio procedures. Several people never once transmitted their FCC call signs. And an FCC call sign should always be given at the end of an exchange. And people were not doing that. And I've had that beat into me. That's why it was so noticeable to me. That, and there were the various people who just started rattling off things, which, as Joe knows, just screws you up royally when you're net control, because you're not ready to take their information down, or you may have a priority case that you need to deal with before that you take their traffic. But you know, by and large, everything seemed to go fairly smoothly from what I heard. And as a side to that, I'll be happy to help put together some training material for procedures like this, because in an emergency situation, we'd be in a lot more trouble. Back to you.
Okay, good, thanks. Yeah, we try to, we've talked quite a bit about this, and Joe, you might want to make a comment. We basically use our SAG number, SAG 1, SAG 2, whatever it is, and occasionally we try to make an effort to put our call, stick our call in there, but we probably by training of for the event have probably been a little lax as far as the letter of the law with FCC. You want to make a comment on this, Joe? You've had to live with this issue some.
When I did this in CERT in Fremont, we basically, if you were using tactical calls during an exercise or an event, you only use tactical calls. You did not actually use your real call sign.
Okay. Well, when I was in CERT, we were trained, of course, to use tactical call signs. But you, at the end of your exchange, if you and I were passing back and forth addresses within 10 minutes, the last thing that each of us would, in that exchange, would be our FCC call sign. A, to keep it legal, and B, by using your FCC call sign, it says, "I'm done. Go ahead and take other traffic."
Yeah, I kind of disagree. I kind of prefer people not to give their call signs. And the reason why, because it takes up a lot of on-air time.
5 seconds at most.
And people, and the problem is people don't do it only when they're signing off and going away. They if you tell people, oh, you need to use your FCC call sign, what they'll do is they'll, like every exchange, that somebody will use their call sign. And so it slows things down a lot. So, you know, like I, as a net control, I tend to identify with my call sign like every 10 or 20 minutes, just to say, you know, I'm net control, whatever. And that, and also make an announcement to say, this is a controlled net, just so that if some random person turns on their radio and hears a bunch of people talking, they don't just jump in, which actually didn't happen this week or this time. I think it happened once very early in the morning. Somebody came in like 8 o'clock or something, but it wouldn't do it. Don, go ahead.
Yeah. Did anybody read the SAG and rest stop instructions that I sent everybody? Because on there it says when you end the transmission, you end with your FCC call sign.
That's right.
That's what they're. And those instructions were from Chuck back when all I did was rewrite them.
Yeah. No, I've definitely heard that used as a technique to do it. I wasn't like encouraging people to use their call signs or telling them they should or anything like that. So
that is a change.
The point that I set it all out.
That's a change from procedures that we used to do. And that's why I usually didn't give my call sign, just because of the habit of not doing it in previous bike races. So I don't know, maybe we should have a training session and do it the right way. And then remember, you know, to do it that way every year.
Having participated in many events, including the big ones, like the 100-mile bike ride or run that goes through the Sierra and then the horse event and numerous bicycle events, if we refer to Part 97 of the FCC rules, you will find that we have to give your call sign at the end of your transmission. It's, so let's review the rules and then you're good. But if you want to have more conversation about that sometime, we can do it with the rule book. I don't have a copy with me. Unfortunately, I couldn't participate in your event. I had another activity for that day. So,
okay. Well, that's sounds like we came with away so far with a couple of suggestions that we could deal with, and.
I think Mike,
our secretary, is writing all those down, I hope.
Yep.
Yeah, good.
Hand crunch.
I'm still awake.
Yeah, okay, great. Okay. Anyone else that hasn't had a chance to have the open mic?
I think Mike wants to talk.
Oh, I was one of the new guys. This is my first time. I hope, Joe, I didn't cause you any problems in net control. I tried to follow Don's document as best I could. Being a new guy, couple observations. One, the signage, I have to agree on that. There was some spikes like where the, you know, 50K cut off from the 100K, the signage there was absolutely inadequate. And in fact, you know, my driver, who was a bike club member, you know, commented it on himself, saying this is horrible. So I think that'll get back to the club. So hopefully they'll address that. My driver was also, like somebody else commented, not familiar with the course. So I end up doing ham radio work, and also I'm the navigator. I don't necessarily have a problem with that. But, you know, if I'd have known that, I probably would have familiarized myself more with the course beforehand, just so that I'm not talking out my, you know what. Third thing, which is just a minor technical thing, is sometimes I think it potentially in the future we're going to run into, like I did with the SAG vehicle that I was assigned, it had a glass roof, and so we had to attach the magnetic antennas to the hood, which was fortunately still steel. If this had been one of my Jeeps, that wouldn't have worked, because I have a fiberglass roof and an aluminum hood and aluminum fenders and aluminum doors. So we may need to think about that in the future, just something to kind of put back in your head if you see a good solution, and try and remember it, because I think that may come up more. Otherwise, I thought it was a great event. My wife was came with us just to kind of lend a hand, and she hung out with Joe and Net Control, and was really interested in Net Control, and Don was really recruiting her as a ham, and hopefully he was successful. So it was fun, and I'll definitely be doing it again. I look forward to it. And thanks, Don and Joe, for all the work you put into it, and everybody else too. I thought you guys set it up really well. Everything was ready when I got there for SAG duty. Don had put out the document, so I kind of had a pretty good idea what was expected. I thought, from my point of view, it went well.
Yeah, so the non-steel roof thing is kind of a known new problem. We had that with a couple of the when I went over with Eldorado and we were doing the animal control people, a couple of the animal control trucks were new enough that they had aluminum roofs. And so fortunately there was something else steel on the truck that you could put the antenna on. Like they had those frames and stuff for the back and stuff like that, but you could do that. But there was a couple of people who had like problems mounting their antenna. So we probably need to think about some way to mount it, you know, have one or two antennas that can be mounted on a non-steel vehicle.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I saw that vehicle night before, and it appeared that it was going to be a little difficult to mount an antenna on it. Is there anyone else that has a comment that hasn't been heard, or they thought of a new question or comment?
Howard?
Yeah, Paul.
This is Paul. First of all, I want to thank everybody for participating. You made the event a great success. As far as the signage goes, that's not our problem. That's the bike club's problem. And, you know, I know it makes it harder for us to do our job, but again, that's the bike club's problem. The new guy from the bike club, he forgot to bring the SAG signs for the vehicles. So they had to handwrite, you know, all of the, you know, SAG vehicles on and put them on their vehicles. So that was a little tacky. A number of riders were pointing that out, and they were only visible from one side. So the riders on the other side of the road didn't know that you were a SAG vehicle. And but again, that's their problem. And so I'm sure they'll correct that in the future. I have a list of all the instructions, and Lindsay was exactly right. You can use your tactical call sign for the transmissions, but at the end of each transmission, we're required to say our FCC call sign. So I have a list of instructions that detail that, and I can send that out to everybody. So we don't need to. If you want, we can make it a presentation I'll just send that out to the whole club, and that should take care of the problem. I've been doing this for years, and nobody sat on their mic, so that was good. And other than that, everything went very well. So I'm really proud of the club, and we've already been asked to do it again next year. And I talked to the guys from Sacramento, the two rest stop operators, and the one SAGA operator, and they said they had a wonderful time, and they'll be back next year. So if we need them. So I think that's it. And thank you, Howard, for putting together this presentation, and Don and Joe. It was great.
Well, I've been trying to put together a presentation for every meeting, and I think I missed one for some reason. But if any of you have any suggestions for a program that you want, just let me know, and we'll talk to me about it. And we'll try to see if there's a place for it sometime during the year. Because I can run dry on programs occasionally. And I really appreciate everybody sticking with us tonight and hearing it, because we came up with some good thoughts. Thank you. Turn it back to you, President Paul.
Mike has a comment.
Go ahead, Mike.
I was just saying, how about a program on APRS in the future sometime? I don't, being a new guy, I know just a little bit about it. And certainly the bike thing with the DigiPeters and everything made me more aware of it. But I don't know, is there more to learn than that?
Oh, there's a ton of things APRS.
There's a lot of stuff to learn. Like
weather stations and balloons and the space station and all kinds of crazy stuff like that.
Okay, that's a good idea. I'm writing that down in my margin here that I keep my notes, APRS program. And I'll be talking to Joe as a resource to put that together.
The MTAIO bionics unit is actually for balloons. That's why they're packaged the way they're packaged.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, if you go up on Bionics and look and see what their usage is that's what it is. But it works great on our car. So we add the magnet onto it because it doesn't have a magnet on it before. It is a sealed case, okay? With it has gaskets in it to be sealed.
Interesting.
The only thing I'd like to mention, just to everybody, is that. Howard and Joe and Paul, we talked together a little bit about what to do with the trailer. Okay. It was made as a camping trailer. We've kind of converted it partially into be able to use for radios, but we're wasting a asset that we have by not having it for other things. Okay. As an HF station, as a GMRS facility, as Joe had talked about a little bit. But all of that takes effort and some money, okay? Maybe not too much money, because we all have extra gear that just sitting around, not being used. So we need to think about a plan of what to do with it, or just say, well, we'll just park it, and then when we need it next year, or if we need it for an evacuation or something, I guess we'll just do whatever we have to do. So. That's
good.
I'm done. That's a little,
You might think about appointing a committee. It sounds like some of the board members have talked already.
We had a committee when we were meeting personally. Right. Okay. And we had a committee, but then we had COVID and everything got dropped, which was, I had no problem with that. Okay. But, we moved it out of Pine Grove trailer park, the storage area, because that was $35 a month. And that's crazy. I mean, that means that 12 members pay for a year. You with me? Their dues were going to pay. I mean, more than that, we're going to pay just the storage in that trailer storage area. So I have a pad out here, and so we put it up there. So it was a lot easier.
Well, thank you, Don. Thank you for doing that. It's very much appreciated. So, does anybody have any questions about the presentation or about anything? We've been here for almost 2 hours now, so that's good. Does anybody have any questions or comments?
No. I got to get up in a minute. I got a bad back, and it's telling me I've been sitting here too long.
Okay. Yeah.
Me too.
Hey, Howard. If yes. You could take a quick look at the, I sent you a direct message before Joe shuts down the net. Once he shuts down the Zoom, it disappears.
I saw the message.
Okay. Yeah, so I'm going to take the recording of this meeting and put it up on YouTube like I usually do. So it might be a day or two, but that's what I usually do. And then I send a link out to the group. Or to the K6ARC at K6ARC.org, you know, the mailing list. So that way, if somebody didn't come and wants to see what we talk about, they can do that.
All right, good.
All right, you guys.
Any other comments?
See you next
meeting.
Yep, good night all. All right, thank you.
Good night.
No other
good questions. Meeting.
The meeting is adjourned. Yes, yeah, good, very good meeting.